We're going to read this morning from St. Matthew, the 6th chapter, verses 25 through 34. And we talk about favorite verses. One here is mine, the 33rd verse is probably my favorite scripture. You know, I was talking to someone last night, and they were talking about this weather that we had, the bad weather, what they did to be quiet because God was doing his work. Right. And the power and the principalities of the air is of Satan. So Satan was really doing his work, but they call themselves giving God praise by being quiet. But as soon as God started to do his work, give us a pretty, bright, sunshiny day, what do? They put on their shorts, get a case of beer, head to the beach, serving devil while God is doing his work. Amen. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful, Lord, and thankful for all that you do for us, Lord, for the many blessings, God, you give us day by day. Whatever we do, Lord, let us recognize you and your work. Let us recognize who you are, Lord, and all that you do. Bless our hearts, Father, and give us strength. We ask you to bless those, Lord, this morning that are in the Sunday school classes. Father, strengthen them by the words that they hear. God, let them grow up to be strong towers in your holy kingdom. God, we ask you to bless Brother Dale this morning as he prays and meditates your word. Lord, bless him that we may receive of that which you have given unto him. In Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen. St. Matthew 6:25. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat, and the body more than raiment?
Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, neither gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they?
Which of you, by taking thought, can add one cubit unto your stature? Unto his stature. Go ahead.
And why take ye thought for raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin.
And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these.
Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not more clothe you, O ye of little faith?
Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or wherewithal shall we be clothed?
For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things.
But seek ye first the kingdom of God, and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow, for tomorrow shall take thought of the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. God bless you. Be seated. Thank you.
Hallelujah. Amen, amen. You know, it's every morning.
Your honor, they're coming in. We're going to sing number one. 90 in the spiral book. But like I share with people that basically the first thing I do when I get up, when I turn my computer on, I turn it to the voice of God quote for the day. And I say, and my thought is, what do you have for me today? You know? And it's sometimes it's outstanding. And when I go to church, when I come to it, when I get up, I come Lord, what have you got for me today? And you know, Brother Collie has always got something for us. And I appreciate it. I surely do. Amen, amen. Watching you. The one? No. I appreciate that. You're going to have to forgive this old man. The number 160. Amen, amen. We in F. We've done that one before. No, I'm on number 60 there. You're going to have to forgive me. Maybe the Almighty's trying to tell me that. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Thank you, Father. Open the eyes of my heart.
I want to see,
amen.
That just raises hair on my arm.
I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory,
amen.
Pour out your power and love as we sing. Holy, holy, holy. High and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory.
You love him.
Pour out your power and love as we sing. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy.
If you want to see him, he'll make a way, won't he? Man, good to see everybody in the house of the Lord. If you'd like to turn in your scriptures, turn to Revelations 3:14. Revelations 3:14. Remember the announcements that has been made now? The next weekend we'll be eating together and having a time together and fellowship as a dinner and all. So just remember that. And then remember the time down at the playground at Gillsville, remember that, and just get everything ready and make everything to be prepared to where it'll all work in a good shape and all like that. And Brother Al, I got to check with you about some deer meat, but I don't know, maybe we can round up what this one over the other. Somebody going to wound up getting some deer meat if he ain't got none.
So, we got three packs.
We got three packs. Okay, we'll work on that. But Heavenly Father, we thank you this day for your grace, Lord, and your love unto us that Father, that we may be able to, Lord, just take a little time. God, we know life is made up of many things that we must work, we must live, we must sleep, we must eat and things. But then for us to just dedicate a little bit of time that we could set aside to think about you and to just sit down and listen, Lord, and hear your word as it comes forth. We thank you for that. Thank you for the opportunity. Just bless each one. Remember the sick among us. You said you sent your word and healed us and delivered us from destruction. So guide and bless each one. We love you and we thank you for all things. Forgive our sins and keep us cleansed in the blood in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Revelation 3:14, very familiar with all of us. The day and the hour that we're living, right? And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write, these things saith the Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth. Because thou sayest, I am rich and increased with goods, and have need of nothing, and knowest not that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked. I counsel thee to buy of me gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich, and white raiment that thou mayest be clothed, and that the shame of thy nakedness do not appear, and anoint thine eyes with eye salve, that thou mayest see. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come in to him and will sup with him and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne. Notice now, not on, it's in, see. It's in within. Even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith unto the churches. You may be seated. The Lord add his blessing to the reading of the word. Now, I read the whole part, you know, of the age and the time. And truly, we should be at least by now be able to look and know for surety that this is the very age and time, amen, you know, that Laodicea, people's rights, all kind of things, you know, happening in this day, all the world falling apart. Surely we can see that it's winding down and find the day and the hour that we're living, all right? And that's what we've been striving to speak about for quite a while, is for us to find our place and our time, all right? Because it would, you know, what would it be if we started out and some great messenger come on the scene, you know, and but yet he was dealing with some other age way gone, you know, past or whatever, or Moses would walk up, you know, and I'm going to take you out of the Egypt. Well, we wouldn't want that too much today, right? Because that's not the situation in time. It's not the hour. So then we need to recognize, and that's my point, is to get us to recognize who we are, all right? We've had all of this time to settle down into the bases of deciding whether we've got other prophets to come or other things to happen, you know, anything like that. And we should have by now at least got all of that settled, that we're not looking for another messenger to come and, you know, another prophet or another angel to appear and all of this, that, and the other. We should have all of that settled within our minds, all right? And then with getting that all settled, then we should look to the day and the hour that we're living with more sincerity, more joy, more happiness, instead of being all down and out about how everything's going wrong, you know. And I got a note back there from Sister Cynthia down in, what is it, India. She always writes me a crazy thing. And she said, Brother Dale, don't get down and out. Said you, let's see, what word did she use? In other words, you ain't got no opportunity to be that. You can't be woozy, woozy, wowsy, wowsy, you know. Because I'm not made for that. I know I'm not, but she was just telling me I didn't have no right to think about that. Just leave it alone. All right. But, see, the day and the hour that we're living, to me, is the most important thing that there is. All right? Now, as I said, we should have it settled that Brother Branham was the prophet, brought the message, that's settled. We're not looking for another, somebody to raise up to take over and carry us through. That was back in the 1960s, the late 60s, right in there, that, you know, we came in and 66, 67, and people would get together then, who's going to lead us and who's going to take over and guide us through and everything. Well, that should be settled, you know, with no problem. Well, there's a lot of things that should be settled. It shouldn't be a question or a thought as to trying to get some kind of a new doctrine, a new idea, a new concept or whatever, you know, trying to lead us to another God or trying to do. That should be settled about the truth of the message, the one true and living God, and the things of the hour that we're facing, and, you know, all of that. It should be clear that all of that's settled. That's not even to be thought of or considered. as to whether or not we know where we're at. All right. But now recognizing your day and its message to realize right where you're at and what's taking place. See, then we've got to do that. That's the part for you and I. The all the things, God has provided all of these others. I'll read you a quote in a minute, the Lord willing, we'll run around and talk about, you know, that he said Nathaniel or Nathan, I think they're in the Bible anyhow. He said he had a right to check things out. And he said, we do too. You know, I mean, him speaking about a right to check things out. Well, but I think now everything ought to be checked out. Yeah. That's my point of what I'm getting at. I think that it should be already checked out to know where we're at and what's doing. There shouldn't be any questions on those lines. So then we should get down to realizing the day and the hour that we're living and looking at it. We know the world and how bad it's got and all of the things falling apart, this going that away, Russia's doing this now and this is doing that and all, and, you know, facing this or that or the other. Well, does that mean more to you than to think about the word for the hour that you and I are living? All right? Then we should think about what is within our lives and our thoughts. And you know how I've always tried to bring it, that we've had a messenger to come and bring the message, and we appreciate that. But I've also challenged you on one thought, because always it has been my thought. Because Martin Luther protested the Catholic Church didn't make the Catholic Church mad at him. I mean, they didn't like it, but that was one man. But when the people begin to believe and to try to walk in the light of what he was doing, then they begin to get upset. Well, I mean, my point is, it's fine for us to believe about the messenger, the age and the time and the word of God and all of that, but what about you and I? Well, I didn't know we had to. Well, what are we supposed to do? We're just going to sit around here and, you know, we're just going to goof off and sit around and wait on the... No, we're going to get to it in the message, I hope, today. Not we'll finish Wednesday, of how that when the people begins to cry out for a deliverer. Right? See, now that's... I better pull no bones, no thoughts. But I've always just said, if you're expecting something to happen, just remember. If you're expecting this to take place, you're expecting that to take place, or whatever it is, just remember, it'll never take place if you're not crying out for it. Now, you say, well, no, it can, well, that, you know what that means? That means if we're not crying out for it, we're not a part of it. Do you understand what I'm getting at? You can say God will do what he wants to do because he's going to do it anyway. You're out of the message. You don't have no place to put it in the message. Always been the people crying for a deliverer that brought the deliverer. Always been. I'll read where Brother Run said he don't change. It's always been that somebody's crying for a deliverer. Well, all right. You know what I'm getting at? If me and you ain't getting serious enough and crying out, then we're not part of it. You know that part of the scripture where a sign is crying for the abomination that's done in the city? I think we ought to be crying out for the way things of this message people are going and how they're bringing out all kind of ideas and doctrines and things now that are just garbage. I think that ought to make me and you desperate. If it don't, well, I guess we're not capable of being desperate. Sorry, that's just the way I am, because it's time to be serious about the whole matter. All right. Now, trying to get us to see the very age, the time, we're not concerned about being in Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, you know, Thyatira. We know the age that we're living in, of the time that we're in the age of Laodicea. All right? Now, so then we can read of what is to take place in Laodicea, and we see the things that are taking place are just what I read to you. What we just read here in the scripture is identically the day and the age that we're living. Right? Well, then we shouldn't be concerned to what age we're in. Well, we don't know. We may be in this, we may be in that age. No, there's no thoughts about where we're at. All right? Because we're in the very age to end up all things. All right? Now, but getting all of that covered, because that's what I've been driving at for the longest, is to get us to see right where we're at. Right in the age and time where we're at. All right? And if we can find our time, then it should give us more hopes and ideas or thoughts about what to expect. Because we've been told what to expect. We've been told all the things. It's what I said. It's not looking for somebody to tell us what to expect. We've done been told what to expect. All right? Now, we don't need nobody to come along and interpret that to us of what to expect. It's plain language. When you see this happen, you see that happen, we're in the end. All right. Now, but trying to get a point to us this past Sunday, dwelling on the basis of trying to look at each church age and looking at the messenger to that age and covering it like we did as to be the porter that Jesus said opens the door, you know, and then he calls the sheep. All right. We went through covering the porter throughout all of the scriptures. Not all the scriptures, but a lot of the scriptures about the porter and what his job was. And we find out that he was basically into everything running the temple back in the Old Testament. All right. Now, but really he's the messenger. And the angel to each church age is a messenger to that age and time. Right? Then being that, see, what that messenger does, if you'll go back, like Wade was covering about the porter, if you went up to New York to some big hotel things, you know, and you'd find a guy that was a porter. Well, if he needed to know anything about that building, the arrangements, the meetings, the thing, he's the man to tell you. Well, that was the way it was in the Bible. David set over 200 of them aside when he was bringing forth to get everything, to be porters, and they were all kind of things to be in that line, to be people, and they knew the whole story, and they knew what was going on, and they would keep up with all of the things. The high priest, he may make the announcements, but the porter was the guy that the people depended on to keep up with what all was going on, all right? And see, then he would cover the day and the hour that we're living. I believe we've had a porter for our day, don't you? We've had a messenger. We've had one to bring that message. We're not looking for another porter to come and straighten out this porter. And I'm Southern, sorry, when I say porter. We were laughing the other day when I kept saying gross instead of gross, you know, and I kept saying gross instead of gross. And, hey, I'm Southern. Forget it. This means you get what I'm talking about. All right? But see, we know that each one of those church ages, what did that porter do that Jesus said? He opened the door. All right? What is the open door? It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. The messenger to each age would bring the revelation of Jesus Christ to that age to where the people could follow it. All right. Now, so we wouldn't be looking. Now, there's people crying out, and there's always been people that kind of carried along a little bit of the doctrines and ideas and things, because once it started fading away, you had little fling-offs that come out that held on to some truths as it would coming on down, you know, and coming into the age that we're living, and those doing, but yet you don't put them in each one. You don't take Luther's justification and try to say, that's the message today. It's part of the message.
That's right.
Amen. It's part of the message, but it's not the message because it's further development, right?
Amen.
So then you don't want to do as the prophet said. You don't want to come along and say, okay, now we need to get out of Egypt, so we'll just build us an ark and float out. Well, that wouldn't have been too good to Moses.
Right.
You know. Now, God could have done it if he'd wanted to, but that wasn't the way was not the way he chose it. All right, so he didn't choose anything for all the others. And when it comes down to where we're at, See, we need to know what to expect. And listen. I mean, do you pray for your children? Let me just make a simple statement, make a point. Do you pray for your children? Right. Now, what I mean by that is, are you serious? Are you praying about them and praying for the Lord to bring them? Because they're your children. Well, now, it's not wrong. I'm not saying it's wrong, but you're not praying for the neighbor's kids, right? Now, that's automatic. We pray for everybody. But you understand the point. The point is, if we're to pray for our children, then we're to pray for our children, right? Well, see, then that means that you're recognizing your family and what's taking place and what's needed. Well, that should be the way it is in the gospel. See, we can recognize the day we're living and we know how to pray. Yeah, there's things in the Bible that are said that, you know, has time-wise and setting out, you know, it wouldn't be no good for us today to pray for God to send another Moses. Right? See, that's the point is that you and I need to recognize what's taking place in the hour that we're that's taking place, because that's what we can call for. Now, the children of Israel, they never knew what they were calling for. Now, get my point. Because they probably never thought about God had promised them a Moses. Maybe the priest reminded them that they had been promised this, that, or the other. But get my point. They wasn't praying for a Moses to come down into Egypt and get them out, right? Because they didn't understand. Right? Now, they're praying for a deliverer and whatever, but not a specific thing. Not a feller floating in a little ark, you know, to be their deliverer, all right? Well, see, but you and I, now listen, you and I have no excuse. We know what to pray for. Now listen, don't go off haywire, just listen. Brother Branham prayed for the White House and the Senate and the things. He'd pray for people that called his name, right? He said, we need to pray for the president. But then what did he turn around and do? What did he say? He said, ain't no need of praying for none of this. Is that summing it up? He said, it ain't going to change. Well, what was he being? Honest. Right? But then he could still say, pray for the president, and then he prayed for the president. It's all right. But what was his point? You don't know what to pray for. You don't pray for the president and the House and the Senate. Why? Because that's settled and done. You know. But find out what to pray for. Now, that's my point. Now, listen. See, then, what I was trying to say last Sunday was what? Is we need to know the messenger of the age. The message of the age. Even his duration or whatever you call it, his time period where he appears. I ran across one yesterday that Brother Branham was saying. He said, see, Paul and all of them, he said, they wasn't, in other words, penned in the Bible to come. You know what I mean? It's not penned in there. Paul's coming. He's coming. But this messenger of Malachi 4, Luke 17:30, Revelation 10:7, it's in the Word. So we're not having to try to find something, what age we're in. You get me? It's in the Word of God. It was proclaimed in the Word of God to be those things and what would take us through. All right? But see, still, why would we not be calling for God to keep His Word? Is there any problem? The Lord spoke to me years ago and said, you'll be there with your offspring. Okay. Well, now, who am I supposed to pray for to believe that I'll be there with? Are you with me?
Amen.
Well, is there any problem to remind God what he said? Well, Brother Dale, he just never did tell. Well, then that's between you and him. I'm not throwing off on you. I'm just telling what happened. He told me what would, you know, where I'd be. He called me to give me the scripture. All right? Well, I pray for my family according to that scripture. I'm asking him to fulfill that scripture in my family. But you see, you read the same scripture, you should ask him to fulfill that scripture in your family. Because it's something personal to each one of us. Right? And knowing specifically what to pray for. Come on. We're not supposed, well, let's get together now. They're going to have an election. Let's get together and pray that, you know, that we get the right president. What for? What good is that? I just go back to the Bible. He said, I put in kings, I take out kings. He's going to put in who he wants, and it don't matter whether you vote or what you do, and that's why I don't vote. Are you telling us not to vote? No, I didn't tell you not to vote. I said I didn't vote. Well, I think we should do this, we should do that. Well, that's fine with me. I ain't got no problems with you. But I ain't going to go out and carry no sign that we don't need a Trump, we don't need a Obama, we don't need a this. I'm not going to be that, sorry, because that would be tying up my time. It would be foolish, right? When I realize that he says he's going to put in who he wants to, and the one it's supposed to be is there. This man, maybe he's the one to put us in war with Russia. Well, that's where he's supposed to be. Are you going to tell God how to change it? Are you going to pray against God's will? No, it's just, what are you getting at, Brother Dale? I'm trying to get me and you to think about things more on a personal style and thoughts about ourselves and the hour that we're living that away and what we're expecting to take place in our day. And what is that? For God to fulfill his word. Right? Well. And to know that day that we're living. Yeah. And know, now listen, because this is driving into here for Wednesday too. And to know specifically what you're praying about. And to know by that the very hour and time that we're living. As I've said to you many times, we're here 50 years after the death of the prophet. Why? Because we needed it. We needed it. Right? We've needed this time to try to get prepared against the day. Well, is it preparing us or is it making us to not recognize the day and the hour that we're living? What about me? I'll make a statement, then I won't do it. I know that today, but Brother Branham's message that he was to bring didn't begin until the opening of the seals. Right. Do we believe it that way?
Amen.
Well, I don't know where to believe it. Well, then what do you believe? He said not in the years of preparation. Nope. He said not in the healing campaigns. And nope. That when he begins to sound. What do you mean? I mean trying to see what we're talking about as the day and the time in the Word of God to realize exactly where we're living at and what's taking place. All right, now, we've been talking for quite a while about in Leviticus 25:8 through 10, to covering the release that was to take place in the Bible every 7 years. I've hammered that hard because most people have never thought about a release every 7 years. They think a release every 50 years. They don't consider the other scriptures and the things. But go back into Deuteronomy and go back into Exodus and read your Bible. Amen. And you'll find exactly what I was trying to get us to look at. All right. But then it's amazing in Leviticus there in 25 because it says 7 sevens is 49. And your prophet, you know, he said it. If you need it, I can go back and pick them up. He said what? That those 49 represented the seven church ages. Right. All right. Now, so there's a release every 7 years. It was a release in every church age. For the bride of that age, she was caught up in the revelation of the time, brought out of the age into Jesus Christ, into a bride age, forever age, a release. But then it's special when it comes down to the 50 coming. We went through the messenger coming and having to proclaim in the sixth year of those seven-year release, that sixth year, the high priest would send out a notice of what was to take place. All right. And getting ready. He proclaimed it. All right. Then when you come down to this end time age, if you don't fit it together with the right numbers and getting everything in order, you're going to try to get us into a Laodicean age. And the age is out there. But we're supposed to be called out of it. You following that part of it? All right. Now, see, then we'll be dealing today with one thought to try to make a specific point. There was a messenger would come, and he'd declare that there was going to be a jubilee the next year. That would go each church age. Then the last church age, this messenger, like I said, Paul and them's not written in the Bible to come as their statement of their ministries. Sure, they're there because it's all in the Word. But get the point. But this last day messenger is promised in the Word of God. And specifically to have this age in this time. I wish you'd go back and listen to last Sunday's message. And listen to it very carefully. I've already went through it twice. As to try to an expressing a thought. That those church age messengers, those angels, porters we called them, they brought a message, but it never brought a full release. They started right back over. All right? It brought a baptism of the Holy Ghost into the soul of mankind by the new birth. Yes. It brought them into eternal life by the new birth, but it never brought a change of the body. All right? See, then this age, this messenger had to have a whole lot to deal with. Yeah. Well, that's why I've always been so just blunt about it and talk about it. See, you take Brother Branham and you take his message and you take it right into here and you try to explain this over here with it, it won't work. As I've always said to you in his early ministry, Brother Branham taught what? Body, soul, spirit. But after the seals breaks and coming down, he's going body, spirit, and soul. And that's exactly the fulfillment of the scripture, because the scripture said that the word would be dividing between the soul and spirit and joint and marrow. All right? You take the quotes of his early ministry and try to bring it over into the later ministry. Hey, listen, I've done told you, so don't be so hard about it. He was right, because that was all that mankind knew of that until the opening of the Word. Amen. Then he could know. Amen. Paul didn't know what the seals were. Right. Paul never spoke of Son of Man. Okay. But here's the first thing Brother Brown starts speaking of is Son of Man. See, there was a special time for a special man to fall in the age. All right. Now, we should have that as I started off. Settled to where that's settled. We're not looking for something else. Yeah. Then we're not down to the basis. Well, what do you think about? What's your input on this? I like that good language, you know. Everybody laughs at my Southern, but they'll come up with a, what's your input? I don't have no input. I know what they're saying. I'm not stupid. That means, what do you understand, or what are your thoughts? But we're not supposed to have any thoughts. We're supposed to have God's word. Right? All right. But see, recognizing then specifically where we're at in this age is what I'm talking about. We've had the prophet. He come to bring his message, right? Now, what about you and me? Where's our part? Oh, we're just to sit here and wait. I invite you to go back and read a lot of what you think pertains to this or to that. And you better remember the statements Brother Branham gave, and we will read some of them in here. If the people ain't crying out, there's not going to be a deliverer. But you know what? Somebody's going to do it, so there is already a messenger done spoke. It'll be there, but you and I might not be a part of it. You know, it just might be that Brother Branham is right when he said, I doubt a dozen out of this generation. It might be that there's not but just a few that really are in the message. I didn't make the statements, he did. Okay, listen. Now, this is going to be very valuable to go along, but we ended up the message Sunday afternoon, just clipped it a little bit, how that the messenger always comes at the end of the age, right? And the messenger always comes at the end of the age, okay? So then we've got to find and place that correctly, because if we don't, we'll have it all messed up, right? And see, by looking at it correctly, we can see the church ages and see where everything's at in perfect order. All right? You only have seven church ages, right? And you have seven church age messengers, men. Right? But you got eight manifestations of God in there. Are you done messed up all the way? I'm not. That's Brother Brown's word. That ain't mine. He doesn't use the word eight messengers, because there's not eight messengers. He places in an order to bring it, because the Holy Ghost came himself on Azusa Street. No messenger, the prophet said, to the age, because the Holy Ghost came himself. He said, then as it was on all the others, at the end of the age, the messenger would come. Right? But now, what is the end of the age? What does it mean? Wades into, and I don't deliberately turn away from anything. I just try to bring it on and let him do it. He's talking about the end of things. What is the end of things? Well, the end of something is just when that's finished. That's, you know, we come out here to the edge right here, and there's the end, and I just step off. Now, that's not the word end. He's explaining it, so all I'll say is this way. The end of the first seal is the opening of the second one. The end of the first church age is the opening of the second church age. It's not an end, and I'll read to you where the prophet said there's never no such thing as an abrupt end and a start of anything. All right? So when we talk about the messenger coming at the end of the age, just listen now. Some of you, if you don't get this, please listen to the next messages. Back up a little bit to understand what I'm trying to get at, because I don't have time to back up on everything. All right? But what about the messenger coming at the end of the age to rebuke what was before? And then he brings his message. All right, now, have you read the Bible enough to listen to your prophet? You know that the Holy Ghost in each age spoke to two groups of people. In every age. The Holy Ghost speaks to two groups of people. He speaks to the true. He speaks to the false. Surely what we've read of how that it comes down, you know, anoint your eyes with eye saved, you know, that you can see, and then counsel thee to buy me, you know, oil. And surely you can see that the Holy Ghost is talking not to just one group of people. He's talking to two groups of people. A true bride for each age. But in the next parts, you've got all kind of believers of every form and thoughts that are connected in with the rest of that age and time. He rebukes them. All right? So don't forget now that the messenger, when he comes, he has to rebuke what's been. See? You say, well, that was his message. No. That's getting ready. He rebukes backward, and then he brings his message. And see, then you'll get it in correct order to where the prophet's message will line up correctly. All right? Now listen. What did we find out? That this messenger is to declare in the 48th year, and we covered that, a jubilee to be in the 49th. Go with your seven sevens. Then he's to proclaim a 50th. Somebody, I don't know who it was, handed me the notes. I didn't look around because I was looking at the thing, and somebody copied off, wrote down, all hand wrote all of the messages after the opening of the seals that I've asked you to read. So if you want a copy of them back there, you can run you off your copy of them. Oh, what have I asked you to do? To just simply read all the titles of the sermons after the seals broke. And you'll see that Brother Brown did have the message of eternal life. Because remember, we've got to have somebody. Seven church ages is fine, but that's going to the grave. There's got to be somebody stand here to declare eternity is coming here to take us there. It's not us going there to catch up with it. It's eternity coming here because we're changed right here. Right? It's not up there. We ain't going to heaven and then be made eternal. We're going to be at that here. So it's got to come here. That's why your messenger had to be where it was at. And that's why the last quote that Brother Aaron gave there Wednesday night, and I enjoyed the message, it was what? The seventh angel is going to be on earth at the time of this coming. Right. So then that's fine with me. Right. Ever how you want to make it there, that's your business. All right, but I want to make the point clear to you that that jubilee year coming up is the golden jubilee. A release, yes, we want the new birth. And all that does is releases your soul from death. Puts a claim on your body, but then your body has to be redeemed. Or we're going to have to get a new one. And I don't agree with that. Do you? Right. So, you know, leave it there. It's this body redeemed. It's this body made eternal. Amen. Jesus had nail prints in his body that he raised in. Yeah, so if you, you know, you can go on and do what you want to. But now listen. It's got to be at a specific time. Now, we'd all agree in a hurry that there's got to be a specific messenger. That's the whole point of what I've drove up to here. That you got to agree, you agree wholeheartedly, surely, or you wouldn't be trying to follow this message. That there's got to be a specific messenger with specific qualifications to fit into this age, to do the things that was to be done, to bring it forth and bring the things that can take us all the way into eternal life. So there's got to be something specific, a specific time. Moses tried his best to talk to the children of Israel. You remember? Yes. And he killed an Egyptian, and he thought they'd believe him and listen to him because he was the deliverer. Yes. right then. But they didn't believe him. So they said, you're going to kill us like you're going to kill us, like you killed that one. Well, then he left, and 30 years later, which is one writer gives you 30, is what I'm telling you, you can go with either way. One writer gives you 30, one gives you 40. Okay. It's basically 40 coming down to the end. All right. 40 years that those people were under taskmasters, beating them, killing them, and everything else. But they finally got to crying out for a deliverer. You understand what I mean? They got serious. Right? They got serious about a deliverer that God had promised. And like I've always told you, I'm arrogant and hateful. I know it. Because if I was back there and I had to believe Moses, you better believe that every week they'd get a sermon out of me. You bunch of lazy, good for nothing. You didn't listen to Moses when he come. And you better get serious to cry out for him to come back. Well, there had to be a Pharaoh on the throne, certain one. There had to be all of the things laid in order, and then Moses reappears. And like I've told you, you don't think. You know, they try to make these movies, and they look like, they already get somebody with some common sense to make a movie. When Moses walked up to that Seti, or what his name was, why didn't Seti just say, oh, boy, you're dead. I just cut your throat. He said, well, God, sure God did, but what's the matter? Seti was afraid of him. Right? Come on. Why would he not kill him? When Moses said, let my people go, why didn't he just say, go cut his head off? He's afraid of him. Because he knew Moses could cause an insurrection. And if they killed him, that would be the martyr for the cause, and he would have a lot of trouble. Sure, God was involved in it to make him to where he'd be more afraid. But understand what I'm getting at. He was just flat afraid. All right. But it had to be a certain one on the throne, certain thing. Everything had to be just right. Moses out there with his wife for 40 years. Here he comes. Walking back up there to tell him at a specific time. But you know what? If you kicked that 40 years, you'd find out that the biggest portion of those that didn't believe him when he first was there and went to the desert, they were dead by the time Moses came back. Yep. So there had to be specific people crying out for a deliverer. Right. A group of people, that's if you don't get nothing out of the message today, get the point of what I'm trying to drive at. They got serious about praying. Right. Don't you think it's time we do? Yes. How many of you are praying for the Lord to come? Oh, no, I don't want a bus right now. See, we make them jokes. I thought we were supposed to be wanting to go. Amen. You don't know what, you're not serious about it. It may take persecution. The church has always done better under persecution. It may take that to drive us to the point of being desperate. Well, why don't we pray for it to come? Oh, but I don't want it to come. You know, I don't want things to happen. Do you want God's will to be done? Yes. But no, we don't want that. Are we serious enough to pray? You think John didn't see a lot on the Isle of Patmos? Right? He saw their destructions. He saw everything. But what did he wind up saying? He said, this is going to come one of these days. And then what did he wind up saying? Even though, come Lord Jesus. Bring it on. Yeah, but you're not young like I am, Brother Dale. I was preaching this 40 years ago, and I was a whole lot younger. Because I've always cried and screamed out to you and I that it's our problem. It's not God's problem. It's your problem and my problem because we won't stand up. We won't take God as his word. Right? We're too tied up into the world. Well, that may take care of itself. That's all right. All right, but let's get started on something. Go to number two on the quotes. We'll get a little bit, and then we'll click off, and we'll take up Wednesday. The first quote, don't pull it up, but Brother Brown was talking about it, that we are expected a jubilee, a golden jubilee for the people. Well, let me just read this, okay? Pull back to number one. Let's just read this. We ain't getting in no hurry. Look what he says on number one quote, which is the Queen of Sheba. Okay. In Moses' time, they did not want to accept it. In Noah's time, Elijah's time, they did not want to accept it. And when God sends a gift, now I want you to get it. When God sends a gift, he'll vindicate that gift. All right. And if the people will receive it, they've got a right to test first. To look it over, like Nathaniel did. And the woman at the well, different places. You got a right to check it out with the word. When Brother Moat began to talk to me about a prophet being sent, I didn't go to Greer's Almanac to start looking up things to see if that was true. And I never went to all of these other writers to do. I went to the Word of God to see if it was in the Word of God. And I'm glad I run across a man that I'd say, all right, put it in the Scripture. Well, he just put it in the Scripture for me. I was glad of that. But listen, you understand what he's saying? He'll vindicate the gift, and the people will receive it. Look, they got a right to test first. To look it over. Nathaniel and the woman at the well. You know what the woman at the well? She said, well, without this, we think this, we think this. Then finally, wait a minute, I realize there's something going on because you know this. Yep. See, but she had a right to check it out. Right. Look, but when it's proven to be God, then if the people will, now watch, then if the people will reject it, there's nothing left but chaos. Right. And if the people will receive it, it will be a golden jubilee. Amen. For that people if they will receive it. But it all lays to the people. God does his part. All right. Amen. Now, I think we've had long enough to check out the message and decide whether it's right or not. So it's time to receive it and move on. All right. Now, let's go on into number two now, because it's taken from the Revelation of Jesus Christ, Church Age book. We talk about the revelation of God for the age can come in that age only. And at a specific time, look at the history of Israel. The revelation of God to Moses came only at a specific time of history. And even more specifically, it came as the people cried unto God. Well, you know what? They all blame Moses, didn't they? Well, you know, I kind of like the story. And Moses finally one day said, all that's on God's side, get over here with me. And the earth just swallowed up 250 preachers hearing the censers right off the altar. Jesus himself came at the fullness of time, him being the complete revelation of the Godhead. And in this age, Laodicea, the revelation of God will come in its due time. It will not falter, neither will it be premature. Think on these things and heed it. It's come. We've had the message. Okay. Specifically, a time. We're not to try to get God to fulfill his word about Azusa Street. But now, may I say this, and forgive me for being sarcastic. I know you think I'm hateful when I say it, but why would we want to? Now, we believe in all the gifts of God. We believe in all the gifts of God, so don't misunderstand me. But why would you want to go back to gifts as an Azusa Street gifts to try to prove God to be true? Or this message to be true? You see, come on, folks, that's Satan's trap to get to people, because they want to, well, now, if that's of God, we should be seeing this. We should be having this if that's of God. Don't you realize that, like I said, Wednesday, Sunday, when people will come up to you and say, since our fathers went to sleep, we've heard this. We've heard he's coming. You ought to shake their hand and say, you're fulfilling the word of God. You realize we're fulfilling the word of God by what we believe and our idea. If something happened, we'd believe it. If a certain thing took place, we'd believe it. Where's it ever been that way in the Word? We believe in signs and wonders. We believe in gifts. Hey, I've fought from that ever since I come in this message. I still believe Azusa's treating the gifts. It wasn't just gifts. It was the giver. He brought gifts. Why wouldn't we want gifts? Why should we not have gifts in this church? Well, we're up here above that. Now you've gone wrong, see? You're off the other end of the scale. I'm fighting for truth. To try to get it to see it to where we can see it. And follow the word. All right? So what does he call it now? What about this? Going to number three. On the mark of the beast. What about this year of Jubilee? And I love that because he uses it twice in the message. The year of Jubilee, the Jubilee priest sounded a trumpet, and every slave could go free. The gospel trumpet. I like that. The Jubilee priest, a special priest. You realize when it come up to that 50, they was a special man for every job. Right? It wouldn't just haphazardly fall in and something happened. It was a special man for every job. Everything's right on time, because then it said what? And when the day of Pentecost was fully come. Now, is that all of the scripture? Is that all you can read there? Where were they at? When the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were in one room. Not 121, 120. Right? Everything's right on time. Everything's perfect. Everybody had to be in that one room. Why couldn't the Holy Ghost just fall anywhere in the land? It fell on 3,000 outside, so it scattered out some. But you get what I'm saying? Everything's got to be specific. Right? And look, when you come to that Jubilee year, the Jubilee priest would sound that trumpet. We have had a Jubilee priest to bring us the message. He sounded the trumpet, the gospel trumpet to us. We can listen to it. We get to do it while we're sitting here in the church, and you can read right along with him and hear in that voice. But what about this messenger now coming at the end of the age? I want to get into my thought. Because, see, you're going to have to find out where that messenger's at. What part of the message he's fulfilling and get where that's at. That's my whole point. You know, I make the illustration. Come on now. Make the illustration. What? We're supposed to be at the bus depot. We don't go down to the airport. Well, they got one up under New York. You see, that's where you're so silly. Your mind runs so garbage cans. You're not even listening to what's being said. You're trying to smartetically speak back some thought. One of these days you'll find out that ain't too good. When they start carrying people out of here because of garbage cans, we might change a lot. Because I still look for that. What? Well, that's what the Bible said. Ananias and Sapphira. Yeah, but that was back there. Brother Branham said, let a few Ananias and Sapphira take place. He said, things might change. You know, you're just trying to scare me. Hey, you can't scare people. You can tell the truth, but you can't scare it. But listen. Now, there's got to be a connecting link to all the ages to keep everything tied together. All right? So it's not just drawing out the church ages and showing them. Brother Brown emphatically speaks of it, we'll use it, of what? Of an overlap. An overlap between every age. And he says, there's where the messenger comes, in an overlap. That's why I'm saying to you, listen to what he's talking about. If it's an overlap, then it's not an ending of an age and starting of another. May I quote you, Brother Branham? He said, this last day, age is merely just a carryover from the message of Wesley. Not an abrupt end, but it's just a carryover. You know why it's a carryover, especially in this age? That's what you're not listening. If it's a carryover and he specifically picks Wesley's age, you know, Philadelphia and Laodicea, and a carryover, why would he say it's a carryover? We know they didn't have a whole lot of the word, right? But when you get down to seeing it, where you find out that the Holy Ghost is standing in between Philadelphia and Laodicea, you'll see it's a carryover. You'll see that it's a carryover from one age to the next. Not an abrupt end and starting something else. It's a carryover. It's the Holy Ghost between every age, but specifically in the last days, to carry over. Because you see, what if it carried from Wesley over to Brother Branham all the way over in 62, 63? What if it carried that far? It wouldn't be getting the idea of a carryover, would it? But what if the Holy Ghost can come on Azusa Street? No messenger, the prophet said to the age. Because the Holy Ghost came himself. So then it really is a carryover. Because the Holy Ghost stands in there to carry it across. See, that Holy Ghost was bringing the message down through there until your prophet came on the scene. Because there were already the oneness doctrine had already started. There were already people baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ before Brother Branham come along with it. A lot of the things was already, a lot of truth was already being brought by that Holy Ghost. That we say Azusa Street, and one big man in this message said Azusa Street was false. Well, that's between him and the Lord. But if Azusa Street was false, then where are we at? Yeah, but I just don't believe we got the Holy Ghost like it was, but your prophet said it was, so that's your business. Do what you want to. But what about this? Now, let's just get a little bit, because we'll try to pick up these messengers, and then we'll just drop it. Go ahead to number four, which is the Philadelphian church age. Now, this is the church age book itself, which is in 60. He said, I've called your attention to the lapping over of each one. Now, you'll get here the angel, if you'll watch the way he brought in the age of the Methodist age lapping on, and we'll run over into a little bit of the Philadelphia, now he corrects it, or to the Laodicean, Pentecostal age. All right? So it's a lapping over. Then tomorrow night, the Pentecostal messenger comes back to rebuke these for falling, just as this age rebuked them from falling back here in Sardis in the Lutheran age, the lap over. Where does the messenger come then? Where does the messenger fall at? He's going to fall in that lap over. Because he's going to rebuke backward now if I don't get any more. He's going to rebuke everything before, and I got it laying here. Where Brother Brown said, not in the beginning. He said he comes in the ending. If you don't place that correctly, where have you got yourself? But look, a lapping over. It's not an abrupt end. Let's see. Okay, we're going down. Go to number 5. Philadelphian church age, paragraph 298. What has been said about each age running over into another age? He said he sets for them an open door. That open door is where it's at. The open door is the overlaps and everything's right in that age. Look, there's an overlapping, a melting, or fading into, rather than an abrupt end and a clear-cut start. Now, if you'll listen to what Wade's trying to bring of the word end, you'll see exactly that's what he's talking about. It's not an abrupt end and not a starting. It's an overlap. One leads into the other, all right? See, this age particularly flows into the next age. And not only does this age overflow into the last age, but the last age in many respects, simply a carrying on of the sixth age. Now, if you'll listen to what I just explained, you'll see it. He doesn't mention that in between all the other ages and emphasize it. Why? Because who's going to come between the sixth church age and the seventh to be the messenger to Laodicea? The Holy Ghost himself. So then it's one age, you're just flowing over into the other one. It makes an overlap. All right, you following me? Let's see if I can get down to it. Go ahead with the next, and number 6 from the Philadelphian church age. And tomorrow night, then it goes out of the, just at the end, you know. The angel appears right at the end time, and just at the end time, to do what now? To rebuke the church for losing its first love. Rebuking back, right? And how it's got away from God, like they did down through there, the ages. And at that time, the rapture comes to take the church home. See, he's going all the way into the rapture, right? The church goes up just what? At the time of the message. Right? And so we are nearing the age now. You get that? Did you get it? All right. See, just at the time of the angel of the church, the messenger of the age comes in to rebuke them for losing their first love, trying to bring them back. The same thing the messenger does tonight. Rebukes what? Back and brings a message. Messenger comes back to rebuke them, each age like that, for what they had done. So that makes a lap over in each one of the church ages, just lap right over one another like that, like climbing up the stair steps, laying it down. Messenger comes. He rebukes backward. So that's his message. His message is to rebuke first. And then he brings his message. He said, well, but his message is to rebuke. Hey, come on, I've got a little sense too. We'll go with that. But just go with the other. Did Brother Branham come out preaching the seals in 47? No, he come out rebuking the Pentecostals. He rebuked so much. I know you don't like this one. But he rebuked so much until the Lord had to condemn him about talking about Rickies and Rickettas. Am I right? He said, don't call them that. He said, that's my children. Am I right? That one we don't like, do we? He was a man. Huh? But he rebukes back and he brings a message forward. Because what? It's always come. Go to number 7. We'll try to get 2 more. The 70th week of Daniel. He says, when he went out, in come Pentecost. You know what? Wesley's time. That was lukewarm. Then we go back and we find out what kind of a message would come to the Pentecostals at the end. And remember, each one's come at the end of the age. St. Paul come at the end. The rest of them come down at the end. St. Irenaeus and all the rest of them. The other one's age carried over to the other one, lapped over. and he taken it up and went on to the next age with it. Okay, go to the next one, and get them in a hurry. Number 8, the evening messenger. And you see there had how his message comes, how he sends his message. He can't change that. He always done it. He has to always remain the same. That's the way he's always, he'll always do it. And remember, when does he do it? Just before the destruction. Just at the end of the age, that's when he sends his message to call out his people. They always get them mixed up and all. But right at the end of the age. Now, we won't put up the drawing for this morning. Well, go ahead, flip it up in a hurry if you can. The drawing that Wade made years ago. Huh? You see, here's your overlap. Huh? But by looking at that overlap, look what you've got. Look how many men you've got, but look what you got. Paul, Irenaeus, Martin, that's 3. Forrest Columba, Luther's 5, Wesley's 6, Holy Ghost is 7, and Elijah's 8. Yeah, but the prophet said the messenger always comes at the end of the age. Did Paul come at the end of Ephesus or the beginning of Ephesus? Well, Brother Branham come at the end of the age, okay, then how are you going to get over there with it? Well, you just put him off at the end of the age. You move them over. That's really good thinking. But it leaves out that Holy Ghost, because if you do, you're going to push the Holy Ghost out. Are you listening? If you put the messenger at the end of the age, Irenaeus, Columba, Wesley comes right there, and over there comes Elijah. You're going to push the Holy Ghost clean out of the picture. Huh? He said, well, what does that matter to me? Even it don't matter to you, the truth, to know about the Holy Ghost and where he's at and what he's doing. Well, it don't matter to you whether we baptize Father, Son, and Holy Ghost or the Lord Jesus Christ. It don't matter to you whether we believe in a Trinity or one true and living God. If it don't matter, let's eat and drink and be merry. Or tomorrow we die. It don't matter. Now, I wasn't the one that placed them. If I'd have placed that there, if Wade would have drawn that out and placed that there, then you could say, well, that's what he drawed. Now, remember, I've been preaching this. We've been preaching this for 40-something years. This ain't nothing new. But all right, let's just read the last one, because at 15 till we'll quit. Go ahead to number 9. Just remember that. Now, this is from the first seal. So let's let him place what he's doing. Let's let Brother Branham place the age and place the messenger. Right? Then we can't argue about it and say we don't believe it. There's no argument. Then along come the Pentecostal age with the baptism of the Holy Spirit. They cabbage down on that. There could be, cannot be no more ages. That's all of it. That's the Philadelphia, or not the Laodicean age. But then we found in the study of the scripture that the messenger to the age come right at the end of the age every time. Paul come at the end of the age. Well, see, you're going to push him over here, over to the end of the age. I wish we could get that. Most of you have got that drawing, if you'll just look at it. Paul come at the end of the age. We find Irenaeus come at the end of the age. Martin at the end of the age. Luther at the end of the Catholic age. Now, wait a minute. Where's any Catholic age? Comes into the Dark Ages, which would be number 4 church age. It's the darkest point. But listen to what I'm talking about. Luther, end of the Catholic age. Now, listen. And why? Wesley at the end of the Lutheran age. Amen. Now he's placing it, right? Right? Well, he just made a mistake. Well, he made a real good one, because he sure keeps that point. Because look, Wesley at the end of Lutheran age, The Pentecost at the end of the age of sanctification through the baptism of the Holy Ghost, right, which is the Holy Ghost, watch it. And at the end of the Pentecostal age, we're supposed to receive, according to the word, as God helped me tonight to show you through here, that we are to see receive a messenger that will take all those loose ends out there and reveal the whole secret of God for the rapturing of the church. So he placed them. He placed Luther coming at the end of the Catholic age. He placed Wesley coming at the end of Lutheran age. He placed Pentecost coming at the end of Wesley's age, the sanctification. He placed the messenger coming at the end. All right, let's do one more, then we'll quit. Come on, musicians, go with it. And look what he says. This is number 10, which is questions and answers on the seals. Someone might ask about the Pentecost, which was the third age. See, each one of those ages only taking a dip into the Holy Spirit. Justification is a work of the Holy Spirit. Sanctification is a work of the Holy Spirit. But the baptism is the Holy Spirit. That's the reason it took a prophetic prophet to come down. Now, that's not Brother Branham, because he just tells you who it is. Look, that's the reason it took a prophetic prophet to come down. No messenger to the age. Why? Because the Holy Ghost came himself in his fullness of the baptism. Now, tell me the Azusa Street people didn't have the Holy Ghost. You're going to talk to him. But at the end of the age, and it always ends up on the other, we find there the messenger sent, and all these scruples are taking place. Right? So Brother Branham put 8 manifestations of God, but there's only 7 men. You remember the one-eyed black man? He called him the messenger to the age. Right? Brother Branham calls the one-eyed black man the messenger of the age. That's, well, but it's been the Holy Ghost. It was the Holy Ghost there. There's no messenger to come to that age of Azusa Street. The Holy Ghost came himself. You know why the Holy Ghost came? So there could be a flowing between Philadelphia and Laodicea that would allow the Holy Ghost to be here when the prophet got here. What? Now, I'm not throwing no stones at nobody or nothing, but what good would it have been for brought Brother Brown's message in the Wesleyan church age? Right? But you got a gap of time there from about somewhere into the 18s that they begin to cry out. We'll get to that. They begin to cry out for a deliverance of God back in the 18s, in the late 18s. In 19, the Holy Ghost came, 1906. And you started your Pentecostal age. No messenger, because the Holy Ghost came himself. May I quote Brother Branham? He's talking about the church right after Azusa Street. He said they were closer to the coming of the Lord than we are. You want that one? You know why they were closer? Because they listened to God. Because they believed God. You know, we used to be closer in the Baptist than say we are today. You know why? Because we had to fall on God and depend on him. We planted a crop. We had to depend on God to give rain, or we didn't eat. Maybe we're not serious enough because God not allowing us to be brought to our knees yet, but that's the point of the whole message. But I wish you'd do it, and especially somebody on the internet and do it. Go back and check it then of what I give you. Your prophet is the one that said it, that Luther came at the end of the Catholic age. The Catholic age is the dark ages. Not a church age, it's an age. Wesley then come at the end of Luther's age. And what did Wesley do? Rebuke him from getting away from Luther and then brought his message. Wesley rebuking him from getting away from Luther. What did happen? Pentecost rebuking him from getting away from... And what did Brother Brown say? He said, and I rebuke you Pentecostals. Right? He said, I rebuke you Pentecostals from getting away from the Holy Ghost that fell on the day of Azusa Street. And see, then he began to do, and as I gave you there to ask you to read it on Spoken Words Original Seed, Brother Branham is bringing that down. He's laying it down. The Holy Ghost is, he wrote it down exactly and read it off that the Holy Ghost gave to him to bring. And he's coming down with it. And he stopped. And he said, Lord, I've got him out on a limb. Now, what am I going to do? Remember, Holy Spirit said, pick up your pen and write. He preached, in other words, he preached his message. Holy Spirit said, pick up your pen and write. He was going to bring his message. He was already studying it. And he goes back and he reviews right through his message. And when he come up to that point, he says, as of yet, Malachi 4 is not fulfilled. That was 1962. The Holy Ghost had come up to that far, leading the people. Now, he steps over into a prophet. And the prophet brings his message. Not in years of preparation. He brings his message. His message is a message of eternal life. No longer do's and don'ts and things. It's Holy Ghost. Let's stand. Think on these things. You say, yeah, but the messenger come to the end of the age. We believe Paul come to the end of the Ephesus age. Well, we'll get to it Wednesday night, and we'll read where Brother Branham said Paul founded the church at Ephesus. Right? He said, thereby we can establish that the first church age started about A.D. 53. Remember, the church ages is a Gentile dispensation. Paul came as Pentecost, and back in the Bible, Pentecost was falling. He rebuked, and may I quote Brother Branham, the Orthodox Church for getting away from what Jesus taught of the resurrection. Who was Paul rebuking? The Pentecostals back there. Then he brought his message. Then he died and went on, and the people for a while in their denomination, and they, listen, I'm quoting Brother Randall, then the people began to, a cry began to come among the people. And said, when they did, said, God sent another messenger. He sent Irenaeus. Irenaeus rebuked them for getting away from Paul's message and brought his message. Same identical thing for each age. As the people begin to die away and denominate and die, a little group of people starts crying out for deliverance. What's going to bring us out of this church in the end time? It may be just a little group of people. But somebody's going to cry for deliverance. And it's got to be the right way to cry. If you start crying for the deliverance, what are you going to cry for? Lord, get me out of this. Lord, no, I'm not going to pray that way. I'm going to say, Lord, give me grace to survive during the time that this persecution is taking place. Not tribulation, persecution taking place. Give me grace to survive, Lord. And give me the understanding to know what's taking place. That this is your word being fulfilled. Come, Lord Jesus. Go ahead, brother.
The sign of a rebuke. There's a blessed
time that's come. Anybody have a need? The altar's open.
It may be evening, morning, or at noon. The wedding of the bride united with the groom. We shall see the King when He comes. We shall see the King.
What about it?
Hallelujah. We shall see the King.
Glory. Are you sighing and crying?
We shall see the King when He comes.
Do you pray for all of those
He's
that...
coming in power. Oh, hell,
or against
hour.
You? It's very easy to pray for them on your side.
When He comes.
Right? It's easy to pray for everybody that loves you. But you ever pray for them that speak evil against you?
Would Jesus say, well done, oh, go away?
What do you pray? You say, Lord, go out there and zap them. They're against me. Zap them. Well, you know what? That's a good way to get zapped.
We shall see the King.
But remember, the Bible says, whatever you married out will be merited back to you.
We shall see the King. We shall see the King.
Do we pray, Father, forgive them?
We shall see the King when He comes.
You know, nothing can't happen without God being there, using it for our honor and glory.
We shall see the King when He
comes. So what about
it? Oh, my brother. Oh, brother, are you ready for the call?
Listen to the service as Wade tried to bring on the end. I'm just hoping you'll follow that thought. It's not an abrupt end and a start. It just flows from one end to the other.
We shall see the King.
The end of one thing is the beginning of something else.
We shall see the King.
You're dismissed. Remember the service this afternoon.
We shall see the King. Coming in power, oh, hail the blessed hour. We shall see the King when He comes. Oh, my brother, are you ready for the call to crown your